Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Human Law Hangover presentation, Jesus analyzes the previous human law comparison and highlights the human individual and collective attitudes, feelings, and emotions towards God's laws that have come from a human law hangover. Recorded on the 9th of November, 2016, in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Okay, so the subject of our talk now is the human law hangover. Basically, we're very drunk on the aspect of law. We basically have these attitudes about law that is just not very comprehensive. And we really, really struggle. I think it's the word struggle, yeah, with them. Isn't that how it is? Why do we struggle so much? Well, it all starts with our pain, doesn't it, really? Our pain, which has been caused by sin, causes us to have these attitudes that we have about law. So let's have a look at it. Since childhood, I've been exposed only to parental and societal law. And these laws are very inconsistent, as we've seen. Some of them are quite unloving, and particularly when it comes to parental law, often very unloving. And we have only been exposed to that, so we have got quite a deal of pain associated with law. As a result of that, we developed attitudes towards law that come from that experience. So our attitudes are now towards God's law are now basically the same attitude we had or developed towards our parents and their law. Pretty much they are identical. And I have attitudes of God's law which cause me much heartache and pain, because God's laws are different to human laws, but we treat God's laws as if they're the same. And so we think we can get away with things we can't get away with, and that causes us pain. And then we think we can do things that we shouldn't do, that causes pain. Then we don't do the things we should do, and that causes pain. And so at the end of the day, we're causing a lot of pain by having the same attitude that we had towards parental law and projecting that attitude on God. So as a result of that, we find law very incomprehensible. We do. It's a problem, isn't it? So if I really need to examine my attitude towards God's laws if I want to become happy. Isn't that the case? Because if I have the attitude that I currently have, then obviously I'll keep doing the things that I currently do, and if I keep doing that, I'll end up with the same results I currently have. And remember, we examined these results in the very first assistance group, and we said the result was we're causing a lot of our own pain and suffering. That's the result. So if we ever want to be happy, we're going to have to stop causing our own pain and suffering, and since a lot of our pain and suffering comes from the fact that we're disobeying law, we really need to change our attitude to the obedience to God's law. So let's examine some of these things. We need to examine how the attitudes affect my relationship with God's laws and principles. So I need to give it some contemplation, some real decent thought of how these attitudes are impacting upon my life and actually generating my own and others' unhappiness. I need to examine that. So human and parental law has created attitudes, emotions and belief within me about God's laws and principles that harm my perception and ability to engage my will to be obedient to God's laws. So my perception, my view of it is all skewed. And in that way, we are like a drunkard, really, who sees everything completely different to when he's normal. You know, all of a sudden, many drunkards turn into, like, raging alcoholics, don't they? So they perceive everybody as against them when they're drunk. Other drunkards see everything as, oh, it's all blissfully happy. We're all working along unaware. Isn't it wonderful? And in some ways, we're like that as well, where we're blissfully unaware, or we think we're blissfully unaware of what's going on, all the same time our soul degrading. And oftentimes, by the time we arrive in the spirit world, we've degraded ourselves so far, we say, why? How did we get here? What happened? And it's far better to know what is happening now while we're here, and to change that. So let's examine some of these hangovers. And what we're going to do here is get the original comparison that we were making and then ask the basic question. But I want you to tell me how you feel about that question. Does that make sense? So let's look at the first one. The first one of the law comparison was, the lawmaker is also the law enforcer and fully enforces obedience to every law. So this is God fully enforcing. He's the maker and the enforcer, and he fully forces every obedience to all of the laws that he makes. There's no if, buts or maybes, no negotiation, none of that. It's all just permanent. Now contrast that with the human lawmaker. The lawmaker is not the law enforcer or policing officer, and the law enforcer is not able to fully enforce obedience to every law. So what does that do to us? What attitude does that create in us? This attitude that I can get away with things if I want to. What does that do to us? What do you think? If we come down to in the front here to, Karina, that's right. Sorry, Karina.
I've just found it really amazing reflecting on all this to see that I really believe that I get away with it.
Yeah, yeah.
It's so a concrete belief.
Yes.
That I know about some of God's laws. I watch myself do it.
Yes.
And I honestly think
that he's going to tolerate that somehow.
It's never going to have an effect.
And it's never going to catch up with you.
No. It's quite astonishing.
Yeah. No.
It's just like a drunkard.
Yeah, yeah, it is. No, you're spot on. That's why we called it the hangover, right?
And I've often thought, you know, you try and talk to someone who's really drunk, it's like putting energy into a paper bag with a hole in the bottom. And that is like me trying to tell me that I'm not going to get away with it. It's la, la, la.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, it's a wonderful realization, actually. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, lovely comment. If we go down to thanks. Felix.
Do you also mean situations where I've done that in the past and I've woken up and like that I didn't actually get away with it and I thought I would for so long?
Yeah, you could also point out those.
Yeah, I really relate to the just if something's like really compulsive and craving, then well, everybody does that. I should be able to get away with it.
Yeah,
and then you know I can.
And you do it. What happened when you did it?
Oh, just end up turning to shit.
Yeah, that's basically right.
Just especially the belief that I can get around an addiction, like I can. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, you can indulge your addiction, but cleverly get around it.
Yes.
And
Yeah, no, it's a big thing, isn't it? If you think about it, it's a big thing. If we go straight back behind on this side and then across to Rita on this side. Thanks, Mary.
Become very manipulative. Sorry.
Yes.
Become very manipulative and try and play the rules to my favour.
Yeah.
So when a policeman would come up next to the car, you know, try and chat them up and really yucky.
Yeah.
Weasley kind of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. And so what do we do with God there? We start trying to chat God off as well, do we?
Yeah, manipulate God's
You should let me get away with it. I thought you were merciful. You should let me get away with it. If you're merciful, that means you're not merciful. I don't like you anymore. You know, that's the kind of attitudes we have with God, isn't it, too? Same thing. Yeah. Rita, you would like?
I think I do it later, like when I'm in the spirit world, when I can feel my emotion. And before divine truth, I went to confession.
Yeah.
And it was all good.
Yeah. So sort of like go to confession, it's all good, but now you don't go to confession, wait till the spirit will deal with it then. In other words, we have this attitude of putting it off. Putting off the realization, putting off as long as possible. And why do we do that? It's primarily, isn't it, just to feed our addictions, isn't it? At the end of the day, it's just because we want to keep doing what we're doing. We don't want to change. Yep. So there's some attitudes there that we really need to examine, aren't there? Let's just go to the next one. Next one of the comparison was the lawmaker and enforcer is infinitely and always aware, perfect and infallible. So this is about God knowing exactly every single thing you're thinking, feeling, doing, and thinking of doing, and desiring to do, and measuring all of those things through these mathematical equations we talked about in the permanence principles and so forth. So God's measuring all of that. That's the way God is with law. What's the human lawmaker and law enforcers like? Well, they've got very little awareness of what we're doing at any point in time, unless they're right there measuring what we're doing. Right, and this is why pretty much, you know, there's at least 50% of all lawbreakers get away with breaking a law, and in some cases it goes right up, like in terms of rapes and childhood abuse, it goes up right up to like 90% of them get away with it, right? Because of this problem, right? Now, what effect has that had on us with our attitude to law? Jada, thanks.
I was just thinking, like, you can just flat out lie to people that try and enforce the law on you.
Yeah.
Whereas, yeah, with God's way, you can't do that.
Yeah, that's right. So you just flat out lie, and because there's no proof, what happens? There's nothing they can do.
You can't be done, yeah.
Nothing they can do.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yet with God, you flat out lie, and he says, well, there's another sin. I'll add that to the other ones you've done. That's what God does, right? So yeah, very big contrast there, isn't there? Yeah, yeah. Anything else that comes to mind? Remember in your outline, we gave you lots of ideas there too. So if we come across to Deidre, and then back up to Anna on this side, and down to Amber on this side, and then across to Dharm. So on this side, Amber, and then Dharm. Thanks,
Deidre. It's like, if no one saw me, I didn't do it.
If no one saw me, yeah. Yeah, if no one saw me, it's like,
I didn't do it.
Yeah. So it's like sort of if no one sees me, then it means I can basically do and think and feel whatever I want.
Absolutely anything I want.
Exactly. Yep. Amber, that one goes back to Anna. Amber, thanks.
I feel as if God's laws aren't very caring because it's not obvious. God's not in my face telling me what to do.
Yeah, so most parents are in your face, aren't they? You disobeyed my law. I'm gonna, off they go. You know, they're raving and screaming at you generally. And even if that's not the case, they're really in your face about it. Now, God's not in your face about it because he's trying to appeal to your heart. So he's not in your face about it. He wants your heart to change. And so that basically means that the average person on this planet feels that unless you're in my face, I'm going to do what I want.
Or you go into a state of, well, you didn't tell me, so how can I be responsible?
Exactly, yeah. We decry self-responsibility immediately, yeah. Go across the Dharm there. And Anna, thanks.
I feel a bit confused because I have a tendency to obey a lot.
Yes.
Not everything. I do know that I'm speeding when I'm driving and not... Yes. Following that law, but otherwise it's like I have been in my life obedient without reflecting,
without question.
Exactly.
Yes. So that usually comes from a childhood where parents required you to obey without question.
Exactly.
Yeah, and so you have very little rebellion, but unfortunately you don't know what laws you should be rebelling against. Does that make sense when it comes to human law? You don't know which ones.
That's true.
Yeah.
Because my tendency is to obey and not
without
not
reflection.
Reflect.
So what's God's aim? To have the law in your heart.
Yes.
And your aim is, no, just tell me the law and I'll do it.
And I'll do it. Exactly. That has been my history.
Yeah, so that's a problem, isn't it?
Yes.
Because God wants the law to be written in our heart, but you want the law to just be written.
And yes. Sort of. Yes.
Yeah. Okay, now let's have a look.
Because I've seen a lot of people get away with a lot of violence towards me and others around me,
yep.
I believe there is no justice.
Yes.
And that justifies my holding on to a lot of rage and a lot of the actions I've taken out of rage.
Very good reflection, yes. This is the trouble with injustice, is that in the end, myself and Mary had a good talk about justice this morning before we came, because we were talking about, you know, what justice really is. And I said to her that justice is about, I can't even remember what I said now, reclamation rather than retribution. Now, what I mean by that is justice is about reclaiming what you've lost, not about trying to make others lose the same thing you lost, right?
Thank you.
Now, that being the case, if justice is about reclamation rather than retribution, then you can see that for the majority of us, when we get angry, we're all about retribution. We're all about punishing others for what we perceive. And we're not about trying to gain back what we lost.
Which only I can do.
Which only we can do by grieving what we've lost and then reclaiming that part of ourselves, you know, that we lost in that process. So the true justice is never going to be accomplished through eye for an eye or tooth for a tooth.
Correct.
Right? And that's why Gandhi said, you know, it makes the whole world blind. The justice of the Bible, the Torah, which is the justice Mary and I grew up with in the first century, you know, that doesn't work at all. Yeah, but we want it to work.
So my definition of justice has been completely incorrect.
Correct.
Based on what you just said.
Correct. Yes, that's what I'm getting at. And so, you know, this is a part of this problem, is because we know we don't believe God sees everything, therefore we don't believe God is ever going to right the wrong in the long term, you see. So we then feel that we must take some action to right the wrong. But instead of reclaiming what we lost, our action that we justify is actually making others lose the same thing we lost.
I've been shown how the condition of the pedophile in the hells,
yeah,
and it did nothing to me.
No, of course, because you think you would have deserved it to be there.
Right. And it didn't do any healing.
No, it won't.
For me.
No, it won't, because while we hold on to that concept of justice, of retribution, personal retribution, I'm talking about here, not God's retribution, but
yes,
personal retribution, we are never, ever going to heal, ever.
I understand that.
This is a major problem for people who have been sexually abused and a major problem for people who have experienced murder or other violent crimes in their life. Many times they revert to looking for retribution, personal retribution, and as a result they never heal. Even after they pass in the spirit world, they never heal.
That's where I'm at now.
Yep.
Yeah. Thank you.
So that needs to change, if we're ever going to be happy. Okay, let's look at another one. Laws are created by the lawmaker only to benefit all creation. Isn't that wonderful? God creates laws only to benefit creation. But the contrast is, we on earth create laws for all sorts of reasons. Sometimes it's just because the lawmaker wants to make a law and force other people to do it. Like in the first century, one of the laws we had to obey was you had to pay the temple tax, right? That was just because the priests wanted to get enough money and they were the richest people in the country and they wanted to maintain that, you know, wealth. And that's the only reason why they made that law. No other reason, no other purpose. You know, so naturally, quite a few people wanted to rebel against it, of course. Then there's sometimes it's for the human, sometimes it's for the enforcer, and sometimes it's for all creatures, but very rarely for all creatures. So what's the subsequent result of that? If we come down to front there, to Karina again. Thanks.
I think as a society we tend to be very sceptical of the laws, and what I've noticed in the Australian society, I've got a camper van and there's this people, you go to a camp space and they'll all band together and want to tell you what you can get away with, and it's like, if you've got five things you can tell people what they can get away with, you're really going to be popular.
Yeah, you're in the in crowd, you know? Yeah.
And it's just this sort of underworld, you know, let's just tell each other what we can get. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's awful.
Yeah. And it comes partly from inconsistency of law, doesn't it, really? Any other things? There's plenty of things mentioned in your outline, isn't there, under that? So, thanks, Natalie.
I feel like lawmakers are unfair because I've seen police officers talking on the phone while they're driving a car, so I straight away get in a rage, like, well, why are you above the law? And if you can get away with it when you're not looking, I'm going to try and get away with it too.
So, of course, yeah.
Big anger inside of me about who polices the police, who governs their decisions, because they seemingly have all this power that they can do whatever they like with. And I feel really... unfair about that.
Yeah, so there's a lot of childhood feelings about unfairness being imposed upon the police there.
Yeah.
Okay, well, there's not too many comments there, so I'm going to move on, but there's a lot of comments you could be making. Yeah, let's look at the next one. Laws created to maintain survivability, growth and transformation of all matter and living creatures within the universe. That's why God creates laws. Why do humans create laws? Well, they primarily create laws just for the purpose of being a deterrent by enforcing punishment and discouraging the most disobedient. That's the reason for human laws. So what's our hangover from that? What happens there? If we go right up the back, thanks, to Shula, and then right down the front to Patty.
Yeah, I feel forced to obey, that I have to obey, otherwise, you know, it's a control thing, really.
Yes, so you sort of feel controlled all the time.
Yeah.
Don't want to obey, but
yeah,
feel like you have to. Mm. Yeah, yeah. Patty, thanks. If we come to Deidre on this side for them, Mike on this side, thanks.
I really feel like Anna. Compliance, basically, is the way I was. I was a very compliant child.
Yeah.
But what I feel then out of human law is the constant deterrent to development. You know, just, you can't be this, you can't be that, you've got to be what I expect you to be.
Yeah, that's one thing I notice. See, because we don't have this view of law, we have that view of law, I notice that a lot of people who've been compliant in their childhood now are very afraid to act as adults, very afraid to do, very afraid to experiment, very afraid to do new things, very afraid to create. And they really are carrying over this obedience. If someone tells me to do it, I'll do it. But if somebody doesn't tell me to do it, then what do I do? I don't know. I don't know what to do. Yeah. Tell me what to do and I'll do it. And this makes us very open to manipulation. It also makes us very open to things like gurus and other people who are willing to tell you what to do and force you into doing things through manipulation. So these are problems, but it is a part of this hangover, isn't it? Yeah.
In the hangover, I feel the deadening of my self-awareness.
Yes.
It's just been squashed.
Yes.
I'm really struggling to find it.
Yes. So the trouble with always doing everything like because you're afraid of a negative result is that in the end, you become so afraid of experimentation. And one of the things that we've been talking about from day one in these groups is the need to experiment, haven't we? Mm-hmm. So if you examine your willingness to experiment, you can see that often it's because of the hangover that you're not experimenting. You're so afraid that someone's going to come along and knock you down that you basically feel like you don't want to go out and risk something unless you get knocked, in case you get knocked down. And this is an attitude that is also a hangover attitude that prevents us from acting positively in regard to law.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep. So, Deidre, thanks.
I feel if I slog my guts out to do something right, I just get no rewards. Like, it's all about punishment, but if you do the right thing, well, it's like F you.
Yeah.
Oh, so that's how I feel.
Yeah. So what's the point of doing the right thing?
Yeah.
May as well not bother. Everybody gets away with doing the wrong thing. I might as well get away with doing the wrong thing. Is what we start thinking, yeah? Yeah. If we go back to Julie and then back to Bruce on this side, and on this side, who had their hand up? No one. So Julie first and then Bruce.
Look, I've had it all skew if. I've thought that I say with police, okay, I was self-responsible, but in fact all it was the fear of the fine.
Yeah.
And I'm looking around, I don't want to lose $200, you know. So I'm looking around, I'm thinking I'm self-responsible, but it's got nothing to do with it.
No. No.
Yeah.
It's just a motivation of losing some money.
That's it. Yeah. And a few points.
Yeah. And because...
So it's a control.
Most people in society view money as one of the most important resources they have. The police now make money one of the punishment systems because it affects you where you hurt the most.
And it works.
Yeah, and it works, of course.
Yeah.
But is it changing the heart?
Nothing.
Not at all.
No. And I'm not self-responsible at all.
No. You're just forced. It's forced upon you.
I'm rebelling.
Yeah. Well, you're rebelling until, you know, you're looking around. Yeah. That's good. So you're not in that much rebellion, particularly when you're driving. But if you examine God's laws, you can see, because there's no policeman looking around keeping an eye on your shoulder and there's no pocket payment that comes out, you go, I'll give up from trying to obey any of God's laws. I'll just do what I want.
That's right, yeah. He needs to have a monetary...
a monetary system. Well, the Catholics introduced that.
Well, they did, yeah.
So that's the purgatory system, right?
Yeah.
Where you pay to get out of purgatory because of all the bad things you've done and so forth. That's the purgatory system, yeah.
Yeah, so
Does that work? How many Catholics obey law? No, there's still just as many Catholics who don't obey law as there is anybody else who don't obey law, right?
Yeah.
They just pay for it to the church now. So at the end of the day, it still really doesn't work, does it? Unless your heart changes, nothing's really going to work.
No.
Yeah. Yeah. We go back to Bruce.
I sort of realise I have a major disagreement with man-made law in that I feel more that it's made for ulterior motive.
Yes.
You know, it's made for financial gain. It's made for control.
Yeah.
It's not made for anything that has to do with growth or protection of people, really. I mean, it is, but it isn't. You know, there's too many laws that are now generated around money.
Yep.
And therefore, I'm okay with God's laws, but human laws, nah.
Yeah.
So I have a sort of, major opposition to them, I guess, is reality.
So most people have the attitude as a result of that this whole attitude that I was saying right at the beginning of obey human law until it disagrees with God's law. Most of us have the attitude, disobey human law as much as possible. And then what attitude do we project on the God's law? Well, it's a bit confusing then, isn't it? Do I obey God's laws?
That's probably where I'm at. I flaunt the law.
Yeah.
Really, my attitudes to things, yeah.
So it's a natural desire to thwart the law or get away with the law. So naturally this natural desire must be carried over probably onto God's laws, right? If it's a natural desire with human, it's probably going to be a natural desire with God too.
Yeah, it's hereditary. Yeah, it's, I can see it.
It is hereditary, but can we say that it's not our own decision in the end? It is our own decision, isn't it?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. I mean, I've added to it. No problem about that.
Yeah. So just be very careful of keeping on blaming other external factors other than your own desire. Yeah. Let's move on to the next one, shall we? We've got 9 of these, so let's have a look at them. Laws operate whether the creation is aware or not. That's God. That's God's way. Human laws. Laws operate only if the police and the law enforcer is aware and willing to enforce the law. Right. So what does that do to us? If we go Teresa and then in front to Ivana.
Makes us really sneaky and think, how can I be clever and devise new ways of breaking the law?
Yeah. Yeah, it's like it encourages us to be sneaky and manipulative. So God's laws are trying to correct us from being sneaky and manipulative. And human laws basically encourage us to be sneaky and manipulative.
And then I feel good when I can sometimes get away with things because they're not watching or I don't get caught. Yeah.
Exactly. There's almost this pride in yourself. Oh, look what I did there. I'm pretty good. Man, I got away with that one. I did that. Man, that was fantastic, wasn't it? Look how good I am. You put that out on the Facebook. I did this and I did that. Got away with that. Isn't it fantastic? You know? Yeah. If we go to Dennis over the side, thanks.
A few years ago, I started to tell the truth.
Yeah.
I still get caught and I still get fines, but I found that when... I was truthful with the policeman.
Yep.
I'd sometimes get away with it.
Yeah.
Just but I'm not sure whether I'm manipulating him or whatever. But it works.
Exactly. This is the trouble, isn't it, though? You're truthful, you get away with it, and you go, maybe truth is truth-like.
Yeah.
It's a good motivation to get this truth-like going, right? Yeah.
Well, and it all started for me at court. You know, when I was truthful with the judge, and
yeah.
Wow.
Right, yeah.
And they were telling me that that was the worst person in the world to be in front of, you know. So it's...
Yeah.
But it's... Yeah. And it sort of taught me a big lesson.
Yeah, yeah. But it's still got the problem with still yeah. breaking law.
Yes, I'll still do it. So, I'm just honest about it. Yeah. Okay, all right, give me a fine and that's it.
So even the mercy is not helping that. So that's an issue. You see, and this gets to this section. Maybe we should move to the section about this next section, which is about the heart, because this is where I'd like to spend a fair bit of our time. Can you see from many of your comments, this particular aspect of God's laws is really where we're struggling the most, right? In that God's laws operate on the heart, the soul, the attitude, the character, the thoughts and emotions of the human and the action taken. Human law only operates on the action taken and then only if the action gets caught and then only if somebody wants to prosecute it. Right. Sometimes they just go, well, what's the point? It's just a minor misdemeanor. Might as well just leave it alone. And you know, there's more important things that other people have done. And we'll deal with those. You know, so you get away with it, right? Now, this is our main problem with law. This is our main problem with law. Is that on earth we believe that we should only be penalized for the things we get caught doing. Right? And even then, we will fight it to the hilt. We get a lawyer and he says, don't say the truth, don't tell this, don't say that, don't say this, don't volunteer any information unless you have to. And he just tells you a whole heap of what really crap from the point of view of God. Right? It's all wrong from God's perspective. But he tells you all that. You get away with it. This is what you do. This is how you play the game. This is what they say even, right? And what does that do to us in our heart? What happens to our heart in that process? Can you see what happens to it? It becomes callous, doesn't it? It's like, you know, the whole idea of a callous is that, you know, you rub every day. It's a bit like people who play guitars, you know, you're playing the strings, you're hitting the strings every day. And eventually you get real hard calluses on the end of your fingers and so hard that it's like you can hold down a steel string for 10 hours a day and it doesn't cut you and it doesn't hurt you at all, doesn't affect you at all. It's so calloused, you know. And sometimes we can get we have so big calluses on our heart that we don't understand what the problem is anymore. We don't even think there's a problem anymore, right? And this is a big problem for when we arrive in the spirit world, because our hearts become so calloused that we end up arriving in a dark condition and therefore in a dark place with no understanding of how we got there, because our hearts become so calloused to every single thing that we did wrong. So we might have treated women badly, or we treated men badly, or we treat children badly, or we act dishonestly, or we get away with things all the time. We, you know, we even have in our heart rage and anger and others that we take out towards animals or people and so forth. And all of these things add up and add up and add up. They calcify our heart. So our heart turns into a heart of stone, right? And the problem with our heart being a heart of stone is that now we're desensitized to law. So now we think we can do all of these things and get away with it. We have all these attitudes and we feel we can get away with it. And the problem with that desensitization process that has turned our heart to a heart of stone is that now when we arrive in the reality of the place, you know, so in when you arrive in the spirit world after the introductory areas of being there, you'll be taken to the place where you belong. And for many people, that is far worse than they ever imagined it would be. And the reason why is because our heart has become a heart of stone when it comes to law. Right? So this is a big problem. And we actually even have an attitude that God shouldn't judge our thoughts, and God shouldn't judge our feelings, and God shouldn't judge anything but our actions. And even then, God should have explained to us what those actions are before we thought about taking them, before he judged them. You know, so we have all these attitudes, and none of those attitudes change our heart. And here, the aim of God is to change our heart, our intention, what's going on inside of us as individuals. That's what God wants to change. Right? And yet, human law is not looking at changing heart, is it? It's looking at just changing the action where possible, even if it is possible. Most of the time, it's not even possible to change the action. And that's all it looks at. So that's a major problem, isn't it? Can you see that? And this is the major problem with regard to our human law hangover. So the beauty of understanding God's principles is you now have a chance to open your heart to what God is aiming to do. Right? And this is why we've started going through some of these principles, to open your heart to what the truth is about the laws you break and what's going on. But the heart is the thing that we need to change. And the key is to not be critical of the heart. It is what it is right now. Right? It is what it is right now. The key is to observe what it is right now and observe where the heart has become stone-like and attempt through the reception of God's love but also through the engagement of God's principles to soften it up again, to make it softer again, to make it like a beating heart that's human, you know, the heart of flesh again rather than a stone. Okay, so we have other issues, of course, about consistency. You can see that causes a huge amount of problem, having laws different in each country and each society and each type of person, and whether a man or a woman, the laws are different, and so forth and so forth and so forth. These things cause a great deal of confusion and inconsistency and demonstrate the lack of equality that exists in law. Then we've got things like each law having penalties if disobeyed and rewards when obeyed. Now, this is the problem. We don't think God's laws have rewards. We just look at law and we go, penalty, penalty, penalty. Sometimes when we discuss law and we talk about the law, I can see all of you going, oh, not again, we're talking about law again. You know, oh, just another penalty, just another penalty. And I'm going, hang on a sec. They're like, the reality is if you can understand God's laws and live in harmony with them, there's huge rewards. Just like the reward of understanding law of aerodynamics compared to just being governed by gravity all the time, right? And in fact, for the large majority of the billions and billions and billions of laws, there are only rewards, right? So that, isn't that wonderful? There's no need for a penalty because you can't even engage the law unless you know it. So there's only a reward. And that's fantastic. Being able to just have law after law after law that you discover, and you go, wow, that's enhanced my life. Wow, that's enhanced my life some more. That enhanced my life. Wow, that's pretty amazing. Wow, you know, and you just keep on being amazed of what gets added to you as a result of obeying law. And this is our attitude from our hangover is, no, it's all about disobedience. It's all about punishment. It's all about penalty. I'm just going to get hammered every time I even look at law. I'm better off just ignoring the fact there's any laws. I might as well be ignorant. What's the point of knowing anything? Because all you do is you know more and you worry more. Isn't that how we really feel like most of the time? Yeah. Now let's have a look at the next one. The penalties and rewards are loving, consistent and predictable. Isn't that wonderful? But we don't believe that. We believe that Like, I'll go in and confess and I get slammed in jail for 10 or 20 years. Somebody else goes in and confess and they get off for 2 years. Like, how fair is that? Like, I have to, you know, I go and confess, but because they don't like the look of my face, I'm going to have more punishment than somebody who's, you know, handsome or pretty or got money or whatever. You know, how fair is that? So then you feel justified not doing the right thing, don't you, after that? You see the inconsistencies and then you feel justified not doing the right thing. But with God, you're always justified doing the right thing. Always. Okay. Can I? I'll just wait until that's done off. Thanks. The last one I wanted to raise is the cause and effect issue. God's laws address both the cause, the reason why we did it, and the effect, what we actually did. Human laws only deal with the fact that you did it. They don't ever examine the reason why you did it, ever. They don't take into account generally why you did things. Although that's not always the case, is it? You get sometimes a fair judge and he looks at the whole situation and sees what led up to it and so forth. Right? So the police may catch you, put you in jail ready for the court. They go to court and the judge sometimes, like most, a lot of judges in Australia are very good judges, I've found, in the sense that they look at the whole history, they examine the whole lead up to the event, and they don't tolerate any crap from people. They are quite specific. They don't tolerate lying. They don't tolerate someone, you know, just trying to weasel their way out of things. So they're quite observant and perceptive. But there's still this issue that we can't actually address the cause, right? There's no law that says that they're going to be able to punish someone who only has a feeling to do something, whereas all of God's laws relate to the causes. This is fantastic for us. Yeah. Alan, do you would like to say?
I just want to clarify if I've seen with these laws you're talking about. There was a guy who set up a sign out the front of his place, a radar ahead. He spray painted a bonnet and stuck it out in his front yard. And at the time, my emotion was, oh,
Alan's,
great.
Alan's story.
Well, I guess simply is the police came into his yard and booked him. And
well, so they should.
Yeah, and the papers, and he justified it because he lost his license for speeding and he was trying to help other people to not lose their license. That was his justification.
Yeah.
But I guess I was sinning.
Very unloving, right?
But am I sinning by supporting, slowing down? And
you're sinning by supporting him.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Certainly. Yeah. Because he's trying to circumnavigate, isn't he, the results of law.
Yeah.
And isn't the law just?
Yeah.
And he's trying to make it unjust.
That's right. So there's like retribution for him to do in what he's doing.
Yeah, he's acting on retribution, not on righting any wrong.
No.
So, you know, that's out of harmony with love.
Yeah.
But we must finish, guys, because we've got another Q&A to have after this and I'm running out of time for it. So, okay, so let's look at the result. We're drunk on our own perception of law. We see God's law similar to how we see human law. We impose our perception of human law onto God's laws. And the result is a large amount of pain and suffering that usually we're quite ignorant of until we hit the spirit world, till we die. Then we die, we arrive in the spirit world, and we wonder why we end up in the place we end up. Right? Now, hopefully for most of us, we're starting to wonder why we're in pain while we're here, rather than waiting to there after we've passed and then wondering why. That would be better, to wonder why now and do something about it now. But what we'll do now is we'll have a break again for 10 minutes. Actually, it might make it a bit shorter break if we can come back at 10 to 1. And we'll just have a 30-minute or so 30-minute Q&A, I think. We're meant to have a 40-minute Q&A, but I think we'll only be able to fit a 30-minute in one. And we have a 30-minute Q&A on the subject of of this subject of the human law comparison hangover and so forth. So we can answer more of your questions there in that subject. And I notice many of you have written down some questions, so I'll have a look at those on the break and we'll come up with trying to answer some of those questions. Thanks, guys.